Alrighty, I got 9 o'clock by my watch. Are we ready to get going? We don't have an organist today, so there's not musical cues for you to be cued to go sit down or to stand or anything. So, good morning, everybody. My name is Jeriah Williams. I am the licensed settled pastor here at Peace. Welcome to Peace UCC Shawano, where our mission is to provide an open and welcoming community to all who may feel God's love. I got you, Joel. I always forget about that. All right. A couple of announcements this morning. We're going to start off with Carol. Let me get you a mic.
Good morning, everyone. Okay. You know, it's that time of the year, and we're getting closer and closer to the chili dinner, November 9th, mark your calendar. Is this being televised anymore? Does it go out? Yeah, okay. Anyone who might not be here in church today, we still need volunteers. There's a lot of empty blanks over there on that board, so I need that to get filled up. More hands make less work, right? That's what it is. Baked goodies. Oh, there we go. Baked goodies. Of course, we need those baked goodies. The raffle prizes will be out in 2 weeks. We're going to have over 40 plus. I had some great donations given to me, which I'm absolutely thrilled, and some of them are really super cute. I might even have to buy some tickets, too. Anyway, now, for on the volunteers, if there's someone that says, well, I'm working. Okay, so you get off at 5 o'clock. The church is still having the dinner till 6:30, and then there's cleanup. If you could only come for an hour or half an hour and help with the cleanup, especially in the kitchen area, to get those dishes away. Because, you know, we're using the real dishes. So we want to have it easy at the end. So if you can come and do that, that makes a difference. Or if you can't make any of it, buy tickets. The tickets are available 2 weeks before the dinner. You can come down here and see Shelley and buy your tickets. Or someone send someone else to buy your tickets. Anyway, that helps the dinner. So I really want to thank everyone behind the scenes that do stuff and before the scenes. And I noticed there's a great flyer there on the church property. I think it's so cool when they drive past Richmond both ways. I don't know who did that, but it's fabulous. I love it. And then there will be one coming up on the bank soon. And I think in another place location in town. So look for that. And if you haven't got your flyers, grab flyers, take them out. Spread the word. That's what it's all about, friends and family to come. We're making it more an event, and it's going to be free to veterans in-house dining, so they need to come in downstairs. But where are you going to go for all you can eat for $9? Really? I don't think you can do that in Shawano. So that's what we're looking for. Or if you just want to take it to go, you can take it to go. So that part is really cool. There will be... At my last notification, there will be some music entertainment in the evening hour. So you got to come and enjoy the chili dinner to find out who it is and enjoy that. I'm trying to make, you know, more fun. So again, thank you. If you have any questions, you want to contact me or whatever, I'm wrapping up most of the baskets this next week or two. So if there's something you want to do or a donation or whatever, you know, let me know or drop it off with Shelley, and Shelley will let me know. But again, thank you. So can I hear some spirit from the Peace team for the chili dinner? Come on, more. All right. Remember, last year we cleared over $4,000, and we did give back to the community, and we're going to do that again with some part of the profit. So thank you so much.
Couple more announcements for this morning. Let me look at my list. This week we'll have Thursday afternoon service at 1:30 here in the Great Room. Immediately following that, if you are interested, United Way is doing their big kickoff fundraiser at the Borders Hotel. There's a flyer over on the yellow bulletin board if you are interested. I'm on the board for that, so I'll be there. Come get some pizza from the Ouija's. just kind of learn what United Way does, learn about some of our nonprofits in the community. It's going to be a really fun event. The cost is a pack of diapers to get in. Speaking of diapers, it is the diaper drive month for the Snuggled with a Hug Diaper Bank. So they are taking children's diapers, any size, any brand, and wipes, any size, any brand, throughout the month of October. That's one of their big pushes, is this month. The other thing they really need at Snuggle with the Hug Diaper Bank is volunteers. So right now, most of the people who volunteer at this are snowbirds. So coming up here in the winter months, they might have to shut down because they don't have enough volunteers. It's one Saturday a month, one Tuesday evening a month. So if you're interested, please reach out to the office and we can put you in contact with Elaine, who is in charge of that. I think that is all I have for announcements. Any other, bless you, good for the whole announcements? No? Okay. So we had a plot twist this morning. Vicky is not here. She's with family this weekend. So normally we would have our electronic music. The electronic music was not on the file that it was supposed to be on. So we'll have one hymn today, and that'll be after. Oh, we have two hymns. Which two?
We got the last two, and we actually got
the
last two.
Okay, never mind. So the only hymn we don't have today is our opening hymn. So I'm not going to ask you to rise and sing that a cappella. Instead, I'll ask JR to come forward, and we'll do our call to worship.
Good morning. Is this working okay? All right, thank you. Please join me in the call to worship. God's love endures forever. Oops, sorry. You want me to start over? Dick, you'd have never done that. You'd have never made that mistake. My apologies. Let us thank the Lord, for the Lord is good. Who can proclaim the mighty acts of the Lord or fully declare God's praise? Remember us, O Lord, when you show favor to your people that we may enjoy your blessings. Amen. Please join me in our unison invocation. Lord Jesus, we gather to worship you today with hearts full of joy and appreciation for the beauty of your diversity and extravagant welcome. We invite your Holy Spirit to this space to celebrate your goodness and presence in our gathering time together. Prepare our hearts to receive what you have for us today. Amen.
Let's now partake in our tradition of passing of the peace. All right, we don't have music today to cue us, so let's start making our way back. I could sing a little song, I suppose, but Rather not. All righty, we're about halfway there, making progress. Good morning, family. This is always a good time to remind you that we have treats after church and coffee. Please feel free to come partake of the treats and coffee and conversation. Or better yet, the coffee brews also early in the morning, so you could always get coffee prior to service. Well, we don't need to go quite that far. Who's chewing? Oh, it's Lydia. It's okay, Lydia. It's all right. We're not a hard classroom here. We're pretty laissez-faire. More like Montessori. That's what we like to do. Let us join in our responsive prayer of confession. We ask your forgiveness, O Lord, for not being truthful and acknowledging that we have failed you and those you entrusted in our care. We ask you to transform our hearts within so that we will be renewed by our commitment to be the beloved community you are calling us to be. I invite you in this moment of silence to lift up prayers and things on your heart to your God. Please receive these words of grace. God demonstrated his love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Beloved in Christ, our sins are forgiven. Do you want to read today? I mean, JR was giving me a little grief this morning because I didn't give him enough to do. You got up for this. That's fair. I got up for this too. We're in the book of Exodus. We're in chapter 32, verses 1 through 14. When the people saw that Moses delayed to come down from the mountain, the people gathered around Aaron and said to him, "Come, make gods for us who shall go before us. As for this, Moses, the man who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him." Now Aaron said to them, "Take off the gold rings that are on the ears of your wives, your sons, and your daughters, and bring them to me." So all the people took off the gold rings from their ears and brought them to Aaron. He took the gold from them, formed it in a mold, and cast an image of a calf, and they said, "These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt." When Aaron saw this, he built an altar before it. And Aaron made proclamation and said, "Tomorrow shall be a festival to the Lord." They rose early in the next day and offered burnt offerings and brought sacrifices of well-being. And the people sat down to eat and drink, and they rose up to revel. The Lord said to Moses, "Go down at once. Your people, whom you brought up out of the land of Egypt, have acted perversely. They have been quick to turn aside from the way that I commanded them. They have cast for themselves an image of a calf and have worshipped it and sacrificed to it and said, 'These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt.'" The Lord said to Moses, "I have seen this people, how stiff-necked they are. Now let me alone so that my wrath may burn hot against them and I may consume them. And of you I will make a great nation." But Moses implored the Lord his God and said, "O Lord, why does your wrath burn hot against your people whom you brought out of the land of Egypt with great power and with a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say, it is with evil intent that he brought them out, to kill them in the mountains, and to consume them from the face of the earth? Turn from your fierce wrath, change your mind, and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, your servants, how you swore to them by your own self, saying to them, I will multiply your descendants like the stars of heaven, and all this land that I have promised, I will give to your descendants, and they shall inherit it forever. And the Lord changed his mind about the disaster that he planned to bring on his people. Here ends our scripture reading. Put my coffee on the wrong side, so we'll with water for now. Hindsight is always 20/20, or at least about half the time, I would say. It's easy for us to look back on this story and look down upon the actions of the Israelites. Surely they should have known better. After all, we worship the same God today that they worshiped, and they must have had similar understandings of Yahweh. Right? Well, I believe when we put this story in their context, we might shift some of our own perspective, both on God and the relationship the Israelites had with God at this point in their journey. See, it's important to remember what has all happened in this story up until this point. At the beginning, there was Abraham. Abraham hears God calling to him, telling him to pick up all of his belongings and leave for a land promised to him and his descendants. So Abraham goes with his family, and eventually he has some children. One important child in our lineage to Christianity was Isaac, who also had a relationship with this Yahweh. Isaac eventually bears Jacob into this world, who bears Joseph, both of whom still have personal relationships with Yahweh. Joseph finds himself in Egypt after his brothers tried to get rid of him, and he has done quite well for himself and is now in charge of all of Egypt's food reserves during hard years of famine. It is at this time that his family reunites with him, and the Israelites leave their promised land and they come to Egypt. Now, this is all right for a while. But years go by, a generation or two, and eventually a new pharaoh comes to power, and he fears that the Israelite population has become too large and thus enslaves them and makes their lives miserable. Now flash forward a few more years, and Moses is born, but then he's raised in the palace as Pharaoh's daughter's adopted son, until one day he is walking around and he notices a slave master abusing one of the Israelites, and he kills him, which causes him to flee to Midian, away from his people and his family. It is not far-fetched to believe that during this time, the Israelite relationship with Yahweh had begun to fade. After all, they were in a foreign land, surrounded by people who worshipped other gods. Moses himself needed to have his relationship with Yahweh rekindled, as we read about in the story of the burning bush, as God reveals himself to Moses that he is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and that God's very name is I Am Who I Am. So following God's call, Moses returns to Egypt to a new Pharaoh who has taken power, and he demands the freedom of the Israelites so that they may return to their land. After 12 plagues upon the Egyptians, the Israelites finally walk free. They cross the Red Sea and enter the wilderness on their journey to the land of their ancestors, and almost immediately begin to realize the gravity of what they have done and the fear of the unknowns on the path ahead. We find them today in our story camped at the base of Mount Sinai, where Moses has gone up to communicate with God and receive instructions going forward to include the Ten Commandments. Moses has left Aaron in charge, and the people are growing restless. See, now they are refugees on the way to a place many of them have only heard about in stories. Their leader has reminded them of a God that was important to their people and might still have been to some of them, but they have intermixed with other cultures already. This God, this Yahweh, this I Am, is different than the other gods. There's no image for him. You can't pray and sacrifice yet at an altar to incur good judgments for him. Moses is getting those instructions up the mountain right now. They have no idea yet how to interact with Yahweh. Only what Moses has done and told them about this God who was the God of their ancestors. So they're in the unknown, away from the only life most of them, if not all of them, had ever known. Stuck in the wilderness, trusting a God they are unfamiliar with. And the one man who had been leading them on this journey is up on a mountain longer than they anticipate for. The Israelites do what I would say is somewhat natural. And they revert back to something that feels like home, something they do understand. And in this case, it is worshiping a golden calf, or a depiction of the god known as Baal. B-A-A-L. Baal was a well-known and trusted god throughout the ancient Near East and Mesopotamian regions. He was known as the king of the gods and the god of fertility and rain, and it was understood that Baal cared deeply for humanity. If you sacrificed to and worshiped Baal, then good things were supposed to come your way. A god of fertility in an agrarian society is paramount to the success and life of agricultural families. So it is not odd to me that the Israelites revert back to this deity, this one whom the Egyptians would have known the most prominent deity in Cana, where they will go and where the Israelites come from, and a god that they had an image for. This Yahweh, who was he to them? Did he make it rain when they had prayed for it? How did they know that the prayers would even be answered? All they had so far were the signs from Moses that got them released from Egypt, the sign of bread from heaven, and the sign of water from a rock while they had been in the wilderness. So they create a standing idol for a different god whom they had more of a relationship with in recent years. Let us not be so quick to judge then when we consider the context of their story and the idols we still create for ourselves today. At this creation, Yahweh becomes rightfully angry, and he prepares to slaughter all of the Israelites, leaving only Moses and his family. But Moses, he pleads with God and bargains with him before coming back down the mountain, and in that pleading, a miracle happens. God changes his mind. The Israelites are saved because Moses reminds God of his promise to their ancestors. And it's a striking image to me because it shows God with a sort of emotion and with a rationalization that we often leave out of our theology when we focus on God being the same today as yesterday as he has always been. If our theology is that God has a specific plan and always sticks to it, then why is this story in our Bible? Why are other accounts in our Bible of human beings bargaining with God, both successfully and unsuccessfully changing his mind? Stories like Abraham bargaining with Lot, or bargaining for Lot's sake, over the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. Stories like Christ in the garden pleading to have this burden taken from him before he is executed on the cross. Stories like the bargain Hannah makes with God, that if God gave her a child, she would ensure that the child followed the Lord their whole life long, and when Samuel is born, he becomes a great prophet to the Israelite people. God changes his mind and listens to people in need. This is not to say there were not repercussions for the abandonment that the people gave to God in favor of Baal. God vowed that it would be only the descendants of the people in the wilderness who would see the promised land and not those who had participated in this reveling and abandonment. Moses himself would only ever see the land from on top of a mountain and would not cross into it. But they were alive, which was more than the original plan God had made. Of this, I hope Moses had some semblance of pride at the path forward and the lives they lived, even though they were tough ones and in the wilderness. So what does this have to do with us today? This story of familiar idols and of God changing his mind. The answer is twofold. First, we all embark on journeys of great change, both in community and individually. None of us are leaving slavery that I know of, so not that level of change, but we do undergo journeys where our whole lives seem to be turned around. Sometimes that's moving across the country, or graduating high school and going to college, becoming grandparents for the first time, learning how to live in a pandemic, or adjusting to the way times have changed. When we embark on these journeys, whether willingly or because we need to, it's important to remember and trust why you began. Trust that God is with you, and don't revert back to what feels familiar just because it is comforting in the moment. The Israelites had a relationship reforming with Yahweh, and they jeopardized it in favor of a God they felt closer to. Sometimes when we fall back to the familiar, rather than lean into the change, we miss out or truly mess up where that journey was leading us and where God might have called us to. The second point I have is the importance of God changing his mind. See, I believe we often feel that when we make decisions, they need to be final. We need to follow through on our actions and to stay true to our word. God, in the heat of the moment in our story today, was about to do something I truly believe he would regret. If he had held that mindset that he needed to follow through with something because he had said he would in that moment, our whole Bible and world would be different today. Instead, he was reminded of a promise that he did say he would do generations ago, and he changed his mind on his actions in the moment. This is both a lesson for immediate scenarios and for long journeys. First, we can become caught up in our own emotions when we have been hurt and betrayed or encounter something unexpected. So let us learn from God in this story that sometimes taking a breath and thinking things through is much better than reacting immediately and out of anger and hurt. Second, if God can change his mind, then so can we. The plan changed after the Israelites worshiped Baal. A whole generation was kept from the promised land, but the journey still continued. As you embark on your journeys into the unknown, may you know that you can change your mind too. That when new information comes to light, when experiences shake you, when you learn more about yourself and those around you, you can change your mind on what those next steps might be too. So as we go forward this week, may you find the strength to journey into the unknown. May you not revert back to standing idols in your life. And may you know that your journey can change as you go. May it be so, and amen. Let us join now in prayer to the great I Am together. Yahweh, Yeshua, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, I am. We come to you today, having lived full lives. We come to you having experienced unknowns, both the youngest of us and the oldest. We come to you knowing that journeys are often difficult. Be gracious, we pray, that you may always forgive us when we stray, that we can always find our way back to you. Walk with us on these journeys. Continue to be with us as Christ was with us. Let us continue to learn from his life, from his example, his ministry. Let us learn again today this prayer that he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. I think we have this song, right? Okay. Let us rise and join then in our first hymn of the day, How Great Is Your Faithfulness, number 423. I do believe I've shared multiple times, maybe not with this group, but I try to not watch the news as often as possible. I find it to be very depressing. I like to experience what's going on around here. However, there's been some very important things in the news recently, particularly pertaining to Israel and Assam. So what I thought we would do today or Hamas rather, not Hassam. What I thought we would do today is Reverend Franz Reigert is our conference minister here in the Wisconsin Conference. He sent out a wonderful letter in the midst of this week after attending a gathering in Milwaukee with other Abrahamic religious leaders. So I thought I would read to you his letter. And it starts, "Dear friends, yesterday morning I attended an interfaith breakfast in Milwaukee. Jewish, Muslim, and Christian friends sat together and shared deep sorrow for all the people of the Holy Land. We acknowledged the raw emotions so many of us feel following the horrific Hamas attacks, the hostage-taking, the ruthless killing of innocent people, and the ensuing military buildup and declaration of war. Leaders of the three Abrahamic religions humbly acknowledged this was a moment of sighs too deep for words. And so we shared the bond of lamentation, profound sadness for such brutal destruction, death, and devastation to Palestinians and Israelis alike. So much anger turned to rage, so much resentment turned to revenge, so much hopelessness in the very land of Isaac, Ishmael, and Jesus. We wondered what to say to the people of our respective faith traditions, many of whom have family or friends in the Holy Land. At times, it seems we need to sit with the psalmist's prayers of lamentation. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice." Psalm 130, verse 1. "Why, O Lord, do you stand far off? Why do you hide yourself in the times of trouble?" Psalm 10, verse 1. "My soul is in deep anguish. How long, O Lord? How long?" Psalm 6, verse 3. This doesn't feel like the right time to weigh in on the complicated economic, religious, and geopolitical issues that have contributed to this long and intractable conflict. The idea of a two-state solution, while once a hoped-for possibility, seems light years away. Perhaps it is best at this moment to acknowledge that the actions of any militia or government may reflect the views of some, but surely not all, of their people. Many Israelis and many Palestinians refuse to hold extreme positions and instead pray for a spirit of compromise that could lead to a respectful and peaceful coexistence. This feels like a time to mourn together and to find solidarity and solace in prayers for all who anguish. This feels like a time to advocate not for one side or the other, but for the humanitarian relief of all who have suffered greatly and are in critical need of food, water, shelter, and security. This feels like a time to acknowledge that although there are no easy solutions, there are good and faithful Palestinians and Israelis who long for the day when tolerance, peace, and neighborly love will be the way of life in the Holy Land. So where is God in all of this? The Reverend Seth Ethan Carey, my sister Gretchen's gifted pastor at First Congregational UCC in Glen Ellen, Illinois, wrote this. "God is amidst the rubble in both Israel and Palestine. God is there cradling the innocent children caught in the crossfire. God dwells with the hostages that are paraded through the streets, keeping a spark of hope alive in them. God abides in Jewish, Muslim, and Christian houses of prayer, wherever people cry out for peace. Shalom, assalamu alaikum, peace be upon you." The Reverend Franz Reigert, Conference Minister of the Wisconsin Conference, UCC. I thought we would take a moment of silence just to acknowledge the horror going on across the world. May there be peace on earth within our lifetimes. Amen.
I'll begin our invitation to generosity with these words. All we have comes from you, O Lord. So we give our offerings and tithes with generous hearts in thanksgiving for all you do for us. May these gifts given today offer hope in proclaiming and sharing the good news of Jesus Christ, our Savior, with all the world. The ushers may come forward.
Let us rise and join in our doxology. Best you guys have ever sounded. Holy cow. That's just blown away. Thank you. Let us join in our prayer of dedication. Take our offerings and tithes, O God. Bless them that they may be used to share your love and blessing in our community and the world. May these offerings provide for the least of these needs and the proclamation of your word to those seeking hope. Amen. Let us join our closing hymn. Yes?
Yes.
Yes. Number 81 in the hymnal. God be with you. streets after church. Please feel free to stay. Always kills me that we have our passing of the peace moment be our fellowship time. So please have fellowship after church too. That'd be wonderful. But in the meantime, receive this benediction. May the love of the Creator sustain you. May the peace of Jesus flow through you. May the presence of the Holy Spirit fill you with grace and give you the courage to share the good news. Amen, and go in peace.